cells and T cells, they leave the bone marrow and thymus, what do they actually do for us? Okay, and hopefully nothing unless we get an infection or something. A dangerous non-cell comes into the body and that, of course, warrants a response. Okay, so let's start this lecture. I won't finish it today by any means, but let's get it started. Okay, so again, most of the images from your book use the lymph node as sort of just the default secondary lymphoid tissue. So here you just see T cells coming in, okay, through the high endothelial vein from the bloodstream. Okay, they've left the thymus, they pass by the negative selection, go off little cell, go off and do us some good. And so the rest of their life they're doing what? Immune surveillance, right? They're cruising through our body, through the bloodstream, through tissues, looking for stuff. Okay? And you know that's how they get into the lymph node. They come through the high endothelial vein. Okay? And there they're going to find APCs. B cells are APCs. We've got a lot of B cells there. Okay? Antigen probably coming in through afferents, lymphatics, okay, from tissue infections. Dendritic cells, again, remember this dendritic cell, although we see him now in the lymph node, he used to maybe be up here in the skin, and he got, you know, stimulated by antigen, and he got into the lymphatics and actively brought it here, okay? So the T cells, once they come in, they're just going to be bouncing around. Hey, B cells, mostly with dendritic cells, okay? Because the you know, this is the T cell zone, this is where most of the T cells hang out, the B cells are mostly out here, okay? But the T cell, this is rich in dendritic cells, which is by far the best antigen-presenting cell in T cells. Okay? And here it says, so we're monitoring antigen, okay? And in state of health, it's just going to be the same self-MHC cell peptides that are not going to get that cell activated, okay? T cells that do not encounter specific antigen, let's get out of here. Let's go out through the efferent lymphatics, back to the bloodstream, and go look elsewhere, okay? And that's what's happening most of the time. However, if T cells do encounter a specific antigen, and hopefully this is non-self, this is a, you know, dangerous non-self peptide from a virus, bacteria, or something, boom, we want that cell to proliferate and differentiate into effector cells. So here you see that clonal expansion. So this is what we need to explain. How does this happen? How do you go from a naive T cell? Does everybody understand that term? I've used the term naive T cell, naive T cell. Naive lymphocyte is just a lymphocyte that's never encountered this antigen before. Okay? And if you think about sort of its activation state, think of those cells as just sort of sitting down here. Same thing with, you know, an immature dendritic cell, a resting macrophage. Unless you're being stimulated by antigen through, you know, PAM receptors or antibody or T cell receptors, the activation state of these cells in the immune system is very low. But the key is if dangerous non-self comes in, you know, PAM receptor gets engaged or the B cell binds with this antibody, T cell, but, you know, we need to elevate that into an effector cell. We need to ramp it up and agitate it and make it an aggressive cell and start changing, doing things, okay? But how do we get the cell that's a naive cell to an effector cell? That's what we have to discuss. Okay, so here you see a T cell up there. Here's a dendritic cell presenting a non-cell peptide. And this particular T cell says, wow, I bind that with very high affinity. Here you see 3D CD3 signal transduction in the neighborhood. And notice that's called signal one. Okay, your book, every time you get signaling through the T cell receptor, it's signal one. Okay, but that is not going to get, so let's put the activation threshold, T cell activation threshold here. Get to an effector cell, we have to get you above that level. And signaling through CD3 might get you here, but signaling CD3 is typically not going to get you over the activation threshold. That is going to require minimum what's called the co-stimulatory signal, which is an interaction between a molecule called B7 on the APC and CD28 on the T cell. Okay? So these are definitely two more molecules you need to put to memory. Just like you guys put to memory heavy chains, light chain, CD3, okay, T cell receptor, MHC. Okay, there are some molecules that are essential to understanding. So yes, you do need to understand where B7 is, where CD28 is, who interacts with who, which cell is getting stimulated through this interaction. Okay? In this case, the T cell is the cell getting stimulated. This is a one-way communication from the APC to the T cell. There's actually two versions of B7, B7.1 and B7.2. These are also called CD80 and CD86. I'm just going to call them B7. We're just going to call them B7, the co-stimulatory signal, B7. Okay? So here you see, you know, this is just a brand new thing that we've never needed to talk about these two molecules before because we were never really talking about T cell stimulation. Now we are. So we need to focus on those two guys. Okay? Okay, so here's this interaction. Signal one, followed by signal two. T cell gets above the activation threshold, and we are clonally expanding. We're going to become effective. effector cells. We're going to start releasing cytokines. We're loaded for bear. We're going for it. Okay? We're going to mount an immune response and do something about whatever that antigen came from, that virus infection or bacterial infection. Here is a T cell, exact same APC, expressing exact same MHC peptides, but notice there's no B7 over there. CD28 is over here just unligated. Okay, just sitting here waiting for something. Signal one, not followed by signal two, T cell becomes nerfed. So what those two pictures are showing you is that the ability of the APC to express B7, okay, it's, you know, B7 is not just a background protein always present. B7 is kind of a dangerous molecule because it can activate T cells. We only want the APC to really express significant levels of B7 when it itself has been stimulated. Like this dendritic cell was stimulated through a PAMP receptor and gobbled that bacteria up and says, hey, T cell, look at this peptide. And then it's going to say, you know, to really stimulate you, I know I have to deliver a co-stimulatory signal. So arresting macrophage or arresting dendritic cells has very little B7, if any. Activated cells, they have B7 because they have a different role now. Okay, they used to just be in scavenging mode. I'm just looking for things with my PAMP receptors. But once they find them, they have to go from scavenging mode to what? T cell stimulation mode, and they need the machinery to do it. And that requires MHC peptide, but it also requires B7. Okay. So what if this was one of those autoreactive T cells that left the thymus, snuck out of the thymus, never actually found that peptide in the thymus? Even if AR was being expressed, not every protein is going to be expressed in the thymus. So here's an autoreactive T cell that snuck out. And now let's say we're out in the skin. Here's a dendritic cell. And lo and behold, that dendritic cell is presenting that skin peptide that T cell likes. Boom, signal one. Isn't it good that resting dendritic cell could not deliver the co-stimulatory signal? Isn't that exactly what you'd want to do to an autoreactive T cell? You'd want to energize that cell. You would not want to get that cell proliferating and causing problems. Okay? So again, B7 is an upregulatable molecule. Okay? Another thing that's really required to get that T cell, usually above the activation threshold, mostly because we need to get its role in sort of getting the cell into the cell cycle, is a very important cytokine for T cells called interleukin-2 or IL-2. Okay? So as part of this, ramping these cells up, okay, IL-2 is a very important one, okay? And so here you just see, obviously there's an IL-2 receptor. The T cell has an IL-2 receptor to bind to it. In this case, you actually see that the T cell secreting IL-2 and binding itself. So here, IL-2 works in autocrine fashion, okay? But it also can, this cell can be producing and this cell can be binding. It also works in paracrine fashion as well, okay? But, so there's a lot of inputs into a cell to get it above the activation threshold. I want to make sure you understand the three that I've told you, okay? CD3, CD28, IL-2, that's going to get you where you need to be for the T cell, okay? Here's a question.
Oh, that's CD3 or T cells.
But you literally just said, in order to get the T cells above the activation threshold. Yeah.
So what's the most, like, do you have a good question
of having
B cells? And B cells are still activated.
Yeah.
T cells. CD, so you have.
So you just said, we were just talking about going from A to C, so it's important to have the, like, TCR, what activates it, what it's doing that day.
Okay, so here we go.
T-cells have the pseudo alpha gene with the CD.
So, which one of the following genetic defects would be least likely to inhibit normal activation? Here's a naive T-cell, it finds MHCN, and boom, it's binding with the T-cell receptor. Three of those defects would prevent it probably from getting over the activation threshold and launching into becoming an effector cell. One of them would have no effect whatsoever, and I'm sure you have all chosen the right one, which you did. And that's because you remember that IGF, IGβ are very important signal transduction in the B cell. Right? That's the signaling component of the B cell receptor right next to the immunoglobulin. Okay? But it's irrelevant as far as T cell activation. Very important molecule for this class, but yes, you gotta keep it separate from B and T cell events. Okay, good. Okay. I guess I'm making harder questions. You guys are making it tough. Okay, so since the T cell is basically being activated by APC. Now, the first part of this lecture, we're only focusing on activation of T helper cells. So all this interaction between MHC class 2. And this makes sense, okay? Because again, you're not going to get the CTL responses without T helper. That's what we call T helper cells. T helpers help other cells activate and do things. Even B cells are not going to function normally without T cell help. So that's really what we're focusing on. If you're going to get immune response going, T helper cell activation is the key, okay? So here you see the three cell types that can really activate a T helper cell because you have to have MHC class 2 to do so. Dendritic cell, macrophage, B cell, three MHC class 2 positive cells. I put a big red box around the part I want you to focus on, and that simply is expression levels of MHC, and costimulatory delivery would be what? What's the costimulatory molecule? B7. Okay, so you might want to just put B7 over. And notice, in virtually every case, in a resting, these cells are resting, okay? Or they haven't been stimulated through the PAM receptors or whatever, okay? They have very low levels, both of MHC and B7. But when they get activated, like, oh, here we're binding antigen, we're getting stimulated, these are inducible molecules, upregulated. Because again, in the absence of the microbe, these cells are just in scavenging mode. The B cells cruise around with antibody, hey, I'm binding. Dendritic cells and macrophages with the PAM receptors. Hey, this is boring. There's no LPS. There's no flagellin. I'm bored out of my skull. They don't need to be able to stimulate a T cell. In fact, we don't want them to stimulate a T cell because probably the only T cell that can be stimulated is going to be an autoreactive T cell binding the cell. But in response to antigen, boom, these come up. Okay. And again, so you've seen various pictures. Like here's a macrophage. Obviously, there's PAM receptor PAM interactions. Boom, signal transduction. Boom, up comes B7. Upregulates MHC. It doesn't mean that MHC is never there, but it's going to be upregulated more, okay? Exogenous, you know, all the things related to exogenous peptide presentation, all those things are going to be ramped up because we need more of them. And now this guy goes from scavenging mode to T cell stimulation mode. Hey, here's MHC peptide, here's B7, boom, let's get that T cell activated. So this idea of inducing these very important molecules is very important, okay? Notice it says an immature dendritic cell. An immature dendritic cell is that cell out in the skin or mucosal surfaces that is not stimulated by antigen. Okay, notice, yeah, there's some MHC there, but a lot of PAM receptors, a lot of things to interact with that, but notice B7 is lacking. Okay? Now I've shown you in an earlier lecture that if this dendritic cell actually finds antigen, he's not gonna stay in the skin. That's not the tissue for immune response. The immune response is a secondary lymphoid tissue. So he's gonna get into an afferent, bring it back down to the lymph node, and we know the T cells are arriving all the time, and he's going to be showing this to them. By the time this immature dendritic cell gets there, he's transformed into a mature dendritic cell. They should have said that. It should have said mature. Okay? So they use different terms for these cells. Okay? So you say a resting macrophage or an activated macrophage. For dendritic cell, you say an immature dendritic cell or a mature dendritic cell. Okay? And notice he's loaded with B7, B7.1 and B7.2, but let's just consider B7. A lot of MHC, okay? Looks like he's cross-presented some of it. He took it in, but it's presenting with MHC class 1. This is a scavenger. This is a T-cell stimulator, okay? These cells do the same thing. These are all the different ways that dendritic cell acquires antigen, so just remember that, look at that for yourself. B cells do the same thing, right? Except their antigen receptor is just basically the antibody, so they're not gonna capture very many things. They don't have all the PAM receptors bringing it. They're very specific, whereas the dendritic cell and the macrophage are very broad, is what they can capture. But anyways, notice the antibody does internalize, okay, or I should say the antibody is internalized with whatever it captured. And so whatever it captures can be treated as an exogenous protein, broken down into exogenous peptides, loaded in MHC class 1, IG alpha and IG beta are firing, right? At the end of the IG alpha, IG beta single transduction cascade, what's a really good candidate gene to get turned on? B7, we have to go from scavenging mode to T cell stimulation mode. So let's turn on the B7 gene so that when we now show, hey, T cell, look what I found, okay, a remnant of what we captured with our antibody, we have B7 to 1 and 2. So remember, B cells are also ATCs. They present the T cells what they've captured with their antibody. With high affinity, right? Well, now you were talking about the T cell, and then you switched to B7, which is on the APC, so you lost me at that point.
So, when
there
is a cross
recognition
between the T cell receptor and the
HC
peptide, the cell that's doing the
anti-P-dumping will upregulate the B7 to now be on. No, the B7 is upregulated because signaling through the antibody, not because notice B7 has been upregulated before it even shows it to a T cell. Okay. Now, that's not to say that, because we're just adding little pieces at a time, okay? There's going to be another real important interaction here, something called CD40 ligand, in which the B cell is the receiver of stimulation. In this case, the only cell getting stimulation there, notice the arrows are both going into the T cell. So the B cells are sort of passive in this picture, but in reality, it's not passive. There's other interactions that are going back the other way, and you are correct. Some of those probably do upregulate more B7. But you're going to get B7 expression simply through, getting this naive B cell into the activation state because it receives signal transduction through IGF, IGβ. That will also turn on B7. But so I will shortly introduce the CD40, CD40 ligand interaction, and I'm pretty sure that one of your case studies also deals with CD40 ligand deficiency. Okay, and you'll understand the consequences of that once you want to understand what those proteins are doing. Did that answer your question?
I'm just a little confused because you did say that B7 was a dangerous molecule because it can activate T cells. So if it's present on every single antigen presenting cell,
but only if the APC has been activated. Remember that's sort of the point I'm trying to make with the slides here, showing you that the resting dendritic cell didn't have it.
Okay.
But when he got stimulated by antigen, it came up.
Okay.
So if an autoreactive T cell sort of meandered up and bumped into this guy, presenting a cell peptide that T cell gripped on really good, it's going to get CD3. But since he has been stimulated by antigen, he's still just sort of a immature resting dendritic cell, he hasn't upregulated B7. So that T cell is going to get energized. Right? And that's what we would like to have happen to an autoreactive T cell.
Okay.
So notice this guy here, this cell here has encountered antigen and B7 has been upregulated. Okay. Let's see. Okay, we'll end on this slide here. End class on this slide. Wondering who that strange man walked in. I think he's a student from my other class who probably missed yesterday's lecture. That's why I didn't pass away. Can't let people sit in on a free lecture, right? Just get a good tuition for you. Ideally, you should have asked. So I hope you got this one right. We sort of had two sort of brief discussions on this topic here. Okay? So, true or false? A naive T cell is more likely to be energized after binding to MHC peptide on surface of a resting macrophage. Let's assume that's high affinity binding. than it is to be energized after binding the exact same MHC peptide type it is presented on the surface of the activated. So what's the key difference here? What's the difference between the resting macrophage and the activated macrophage?
B7.
The absence of it, or low levels, okay, is resting, high levels in the activated, okay? So I would say this is very true, okay? Because the T cells get with that resting macrophage, good against signal one. There's the MHC peptide, I'm getting stimulated, but hey, where's B7? My CD28 is sitting here, I'm not getting the co-stimulatory signal. Signal one, not followed by signal two, leads to anergy. The cell probably would have been activated by the activated macrophage, right? And how did you do? Yeah, I just have to start making up better questions, okay? Okay, any questions? Are you with me? Transition from development to what do these cells actually do in the context of an immune response? Okay, so next time, on Monday, I will finish this lecture packet, and I'm going to have time, I want to go back and talk about some antibody stuff that I had to delete from an earlier lecture because of snow day. I want to make sure I can explain some of that to you. It'll be very straightforward. And that's the end of the material. We have exam number two next Wednesday, which is tonight. Okay? Are we all sort of on board? And if not, if you come see me before the next exam, if you haven't started reading the papers, start reading the papers, case studies.